So what I thought I'd do was, you know, before I started talking about mass personalization, I thought let me take you back 50 years. Yeah, let's rewind a little bit. And of course, we're all familiar with this iconic movie. Which one? Any guesses? Godfather. And we've all heard this line, right? Which says, it's not personal, Sonny, it's strictly business. Yeah. And you know, that was an iconic line from that time. And I was thinking that if you sort of now fast forwarded 50 years and think about what a marketeer would like to say, it'll probably sound something like this. It is personal and it is business. Yeah. So personalized, you know, mass personalization or personalized communication, I think is a very critical way of actually generating business for brands and something that marketeers and brands need to look at pretty seriously. So in the next 15 minutes, what I'll do is I'll just talk a little bit about the what, why, and the how, and really end with giving a few examples which I think stand out today. And obviously there are lessons to be learned from those examples. So, I mean, if you go back to the genesis of where this whole personalization thing came from, I think it finds its roots in you know, luxury marketing. There were a few people who were rich, famous, had a lot of money to spend, and really wanted something which was a personal thing for them. And literally, that's how this whole thing of tailoring to your needs came about. So if you go back, it's about London Savile Row, where, you know, there was Janta who bought shirts and suits from the market, and there were people who got it tailored a particular way, all right? And that's where it started from. But however, as things went along, a lot of it started getting democratized, right? So there were more and more people saying, hey, why should it only be for those kind of people? Why can't I also start to have personalized experiences? And that's how it started getting democratized over time. And really, the process of using, you know, data to get seemingly one-on-one communication where the person feels that I am being talked to is really what personalization and mass personalization is all about. And if you look at it as to why is something like this important, of course, one is that it gets consumers emotionally invested in the offering. So what does that mean? As a consumer, I would love to be spoken to one-on-one. I would like to have that connect with the brand or the product that I'm using. And once that connect or the relationship is established, I'm then much more amenable to A, building a strong you know, cohort with that brand, talking about it to other people, and really being a brand evangelist, right? So that's what matters. Second, of course, it makes me feel special because somebody is talking one-on-one to me, and that's something that obviously works for me. And last but not the least, if you really look at it, today, thanks to you know, people, the advent of internet and the digital options, there is a lot more self-expression that happens. So in a way, the personalization is really about a reflection of the self-expression that consumers have in today's context, right? So these are some reasons why mass personalization would make sense from a consumer point of view. Having seen the what of it and the why of it, if you really look at how one could go about doing it, I think there are a couple of you know, learnings here in terms of what could be used in terms of the how of personalization. I think the first one is around, you know, cultural insights and how that can be leveraged. Now, it's no, you know, rocket science to say that all brands and marketeers look at using insights, right, to build their propositions, whether it is product propositions or the communication propositions. And if the insight is also rooted in the culture and the local traditions, it makes it even more powerful. So therefore, one of the key things to look for is, how do I leverage, you know, insights and those cultural insights in order to make it more relevant and meaningful to the consumer? The second part of it is really around, how do I empower consumers, right? And actually give them the power of choice. Now, if you look at it, consumers would like to have the option of selecting stuff. So if I am able to tell them that, look, this is what you need, but I can offer this to you in 5 different colors, in 4 different shapes, and basis your choice and preference, you could sort of tailor make it to suit your needs, right? That empowers me and makes me feel a little bit more closer to the offering that's being put forward. And last but not the least, again, thanks to the massive digital footprint that we leave behind today through the various mechanisms and means that we use, there's a lot of data floating around. Some of them we give voluntarily out, some of them get collected as we crawl through the various forums of internet. And all that data can be sort of analyzed and used to tailor-make things for the consumer, sometimes with their knowledge and sometimes not necessarily with that. But at the end of it, that data is a powerful mechanism for personalizing a lot of offerings and content. So if you look at it, I think these are three ways, I thought, in which you could personalize for the masses. And what I thought I would do was, in the next three or four charts, just share a couple of examples of how some brands have really done this in a very nice and meaningful manner. So the first one I'd like to talk about, again, one of the things I've done also is, in the true spirit of being non-intrusive, I've not plugged any Perfetti brand into this presentation. Yeah. So the one example I would like to take is Coca-Cola. You all are familiar with the brand. So one of the things that they said was, Coca-Cola of course stands for happiness, open happiness. There was a campaign that they did in the summer of 2011 in Australia, where they said, why don't we do one thing, in order to make it a little bit more personal, let's take the Coke bottles, one side of the label, let's personalize with names. So they picked up the top 150 names in the country, through most common names that are being used, and then they sort of put that into their labels. And they started that as a campaign about, share your Coke kind of a thing. Now what happened was, this became a massive hit, and then it got expanded into almost 50 plus countries. And when Coca-Cola looked at it for India, what they said was, can we take it one step ahead? One, of course, is to find the most common names, but India being such a diverse country, I guess that would have been a massive challenge in terms of getting names that are truly common across the country. So what they did was, when they did some work, they found that one of the most relevant things from a cultural point of view is relationships, right? So there's a lot of importance attached to relationships in the country. And it's not just about the relationship. So it could be bro, it could be dad, it could be mom. But the meanings around the relationship were also very important. So what did they do? They said, instead of putting names like Rahul and Srikant and Neha, they said, let's use relationships. And they did a whole campaign around having the labels with various relationships, right? And they did a whole set of communication around it, which really elevated the brand and made it, reach out to consumers at a mass level, yet personalized it to a large extent. So what we'll do is now just see a couple of copies, which sort of actually bring out this point.
Abhi dost to sare bhaag gaye the na yaar, par saath to tune hai beta hai, isliye aaj se tu mera bhai hai.
मतलब और बिठाई
हर रिश्ता बोला मेरा नाम की कोका कोला मेरा नाम की कोका कोला
मुझे ही करना पड़ता है सब कुछ अभी किचन अनपैक कर रही हूँ उसके बाद लिविंग रूम एंड देन डाइनिंग रूम सांस लेने का भी टाइम नहीं है
वो भी ऐसे ही बैठे बैठे मेरे काम का क्रेडिट खा जा रहा है
That's a true example of cultural insight. I got a lot of you at least relating to it and nodding vigorously. Yeah. So again, great example of how the brand leveraged that to get to a beverage is of course sold widely across the country, yet there was a large element of personalization in it, right? Another example is Nike again, right? So this, actually Nike did stuff even way back in 1999. And I quote from one of their CEOs at that point of time, who said Nike's goal is to get more personal, but at scale, right? So they talked about it even back in 1999. And over the years, what they have tried to do is, if you see that example on the right, they have, you order a pair of shoes, and then you can change the color of the pair to whatever you would like. You can even have something printed on it, which is very, very exclusive to you, right? So you could do all sorts of customization with it. And the point was, they launched something called consumer direct offense, right? Which was all about saying, how can I drive business and growth for the brand, yet in a very customized and personalized manner? And that's something that has been in their DNA for the last 20 odd years. And they have in fact taken it one step further in terms of backward integrating it in actually buying out two companies which are huge on data analytics. So they actually picked up two companies called Zodiac and Invertex over the last few years, to which actually enabled them to churn all this data and try and personalize it as much as possible. And of course, supported by the data that they collected from the Nike app and the Nike loyalty points. So again, a great example of how a brand with an attitude has actually managed to take personalization to the next level. Another interesting example is, again, Amazon, right? All of us are familiar with the brand. It's been in India for a few years now. And again, here Jeff Bezos laid out long ago saying that we need to find a way to sort of understand what the consumer behavior has been online, to figure out what they are looking for, what they are not looking for, form a sort of a pattern around the consumer, and then make sure that you deliver offerings which are tailored to the pattern, right? So I'm sure all of us recognize these things when we see, when we are shopping online, which is recommended for you, frequently bought together, or customers who bought this item also looked at, right? These are some things that you see, which actually comes out of something called affinity analysis, where they really look at patterns in terms of what you pick up, what are some of the things that you prefer, you don't prefer, and then sort of guide you in the direction of where they would like to take you. The whole idea being, how do I keep maximizing the value of the ticket size, right? Again, a great example of how some companies do it. Another example, one of my favorites, is what Netflix does, right? Again, Netflix is all about, everything is personalized out there. And interesting fact is that what you see there on the screen when you go into Netflix is, a lot of what you see there is actually recommended for you. And you think what you see as popular on Netflix is actually not popular on Netflix. It is popular for people like you on Netflix. So basis your browsing behavior, basis what you search for, basis what you watch, pause or play, Netflix actually recommends stuff which is pretty much customized to, what your viewing preferences are. And again, taking that to a interesting level in terms of actually trying to drive behavior by gently recommending to you what would be of interest to you. And, I would end by taking one example of the most common way in which we used to spread messages, which is through television, where it's totally democratized. You put it on a TV and then everybody gets to see it. Even that in US is going through a change, where on smart TVs, what's happening is people are able to see ads which are targeted to them, right? So there is a way where the ads are getting targeted. And I think as we go forward, that's likely to be the norm in terms of even the large screen, where of course in digital it's very personalized and very targeted, but even on something like a mainstream media on television, that's increasingly happening as well. Yeah, so those were a few examples I thought I'll share. And again, I'll end with going back to Godfather in terms of what was another interesting quote. And I think it's really about marketers saying, how am I going to make an offer to them that he or she cannot refuse, right? At a very personal and at a very direct level. So I think mass personalization is certainly here to stay. And the sooner and the better way in which marketers can sort of imbibe that and translate that into more relevant and meaningful communication, I think the greater chance for the brand to succeed. Thank you.